I heard you uncles trying to get you in the soundtrack for the movie. That deal? Yeah, we're in the choir.
Yeah.
What? The solo. I got the solo on tape. You ready?
Come on. You just talking to him.
Oh, that's not
good. You wrote?
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about scoring up in Vallejo, man. Let's just take it like that. Scoring up in Vallejo. Pop 1 years or little leagues, which one did you enjoy the most?
say baseball was my, you know, favorite sport. I just played that growing up since I was 3-4 years old. Just working out with my dad and just going out there and practicing and just doing all those things, going to the batting cage, taking grounders. As I got older, you know, just working out, being pushed by my uncle, and, you know, that helped me get to where I needed to be. Basketball was another sport that I really enjoyed because it was something where you really didn't need somebody to be there when you needed to practice, or, you know, you can always pick up the ball and go out there and, you know, practice on your own and work on your free throws and jump shots and dribbling and, you know, all those things you can do by yourself. So, but baseball was my passion. That was something that I always wanted to do and, you know, always felt that, you know, one day that I would actually be able to do that for a living.
Let's talk about, talk about the neighborhood. We talked a little bit more about it, but let's talk about just some of the funny stories with Leewood and Ryan and myself and Sam and everybody playing down there, just having fun all day.
Funny stories that usually came second or third on the list. For the most part, everything was just about going out there and just competing. I mean, as kids, we don't want to lose. So, you know, whether it was basketball, whether it was baseball in the court, it was just something that it made you tougher. It made you a stronger person. Just, you know, being out there, you didn't want to be the weakest person out there. You always wanted to kind of stand out. So, funny stories, I mean, it's just sitting around, joking, talking about each other, talking about what somebody had on, or, you know, a crazy outfit, somebody happened to come in early because they couldn't, you know, stay out late, or they didn't finish their homework. So, you know, those are things we would just get on people about. Fortunately for me, everything evolved around, you know, my house. So for the most part, everybody would actually have to come to my house and, you know, play sports and do things up there. So my parents really didn't mind me being out because I'm, you know, right in the backyard. But for most of the other kids in the neighborhood, once the street lights come on, it's, you know, to make sure you get to the home and do your homework and get ready for school the next day. So, I mean, as far as funny stories, there's really not too many. Like I said, we were more focused on, you know, doing what we love to do, and that was play sports and, you know, be a kid, ride our bikes around the neighborhood, and that was basically it.
I remember we used to play in the backyard, and, but every time you didn't always play, you didn't have practice or anything. Do you feel like you work harder than most kids? Most kids, because you traveled a lot too, so I remember times back there, but you didn't always play. I would love when you did play, but a lot of times, well, not a lot of times, but several times that you didn't play because you had maybe practice later on, you had to go to practice or something, and Roy just let us go back there and play with Leroy. So, did you feel like you worked harder than a lot of the kids for your age?
I mean, at the time, I kind of thought it was unfair, you know, coming home from school. I kind of always wanted to just go out and play, and all the kids from the neighborhood would come up and ring the doorbell and say, you know, you want to go outside and, you know, pick up a game. But for me, it was, you know, I have to finish my homework, and then it was off to Solano Junior High School for, you know, Pop Warner practice. So at the time, like I said, it was more not understanding why. whether it was making a last shot at the buzzer to win the game or whether it was me pitching on the mound just getting a strikeout to win the game or whether it was the touchdown just to put us ahead, you know, in the fourth quarter. It seemed like all those things kind of replayed itself over and over with the same results, which was, you know, all positive. So, you know, I felt that if anybody can put the team on the back and, you know, get us a win, that it would be me. And I just felt all those times and all those hard practices that I wanted to go home or wanted it to end early, I felt that it paid off in the end. I've seen stuff before it happened, you know. It's kind of like I envisioned that before it actually took place. So when it actually presented itself, it was, you know, I kind of knew that, you know, it was my time to do something or make something happen. So the confidence was always here.
Let's talk about the swag. Besides sports, just the swag we have, man. Where do you get that from? Just the style, the shoes, the clothes, the socks, the Nike socks, just the whole swag that you have. Where'd that come from? Talk about tonight, man. Let's talk about tonight. How do you describe? How do you describe tonight? And talk from beginning to end what you remember.
Well, the day started
out. Tell me how you told me yesterday too. Don't get up.
Well, the day started out going to a baseball showcase in Menlo Park. We were out there for hours. Came back home. Just sat around at the house, really not doing, you know, too much on a Friday night, or actually it was Saturday. I actually called my friend Marcus Roberts to come over. We were just at the house, just sitting around, really doing nothing, playing video games and, you know, just talking. And I remember Jason Berghill called me, maybe around 7 o'clock at night, and actually what we were doing, you know, we really didn't have anything planned or going on at night, so we actually, you know, told him to come pick us up. He was actually helping his cousin move at his apartment over in East Vallejo. So probably within, I would say, 30 minutes, you know, they were outside. He called me, told me, you know, we outside, and me and Marcus, we ran down the steps, you know, just anxious to just get out of the house and, you know, just do something. So got in the car. I actually got in the back seat behind Jason, and Marcus got it in the back seat on the passenger side, right behind the passenger. We went and stopped by Bonfire, actually, because I, you know, love candy. So we stopped by Bonfire and got out, got some candy, and got back in the car. And right when we got on 37, I mean, from the time we left the house to bomb here to actually getting back on 37 was probably less than 10 minutes, you know, if that. And as we were just, right when we were getting on 37, we were just picking up speed, maybe going 45 miles per hour. And all of a sudden, I just felt the car just swerving, just side to side, as if somebody was literally just picking up the car and just kind of, you know, rocking it back and forth. And I remember leaning forward. I didn't have on my seatbelt, and I remember leaning forward, and I asked Jason, you know, what was going on? And he actually just kind of leaned back with his hands back like this, you know, like I don't know. And during all this and us having this dialogue back and forth, the car still, you know, it's just like, so I closed my eyes. That's the only thing I could do. I mean, just fear and just being scared and not knowing what was going on at that time, I couldn't even see it. So I closed my eyes, and when I opened my eyes, I just felt myself being on the ground. Not knowing what happened, not knowing that I was actually thrown from the car onto the shoulder of the freeway. And at the time, I just felt like I needed to stand up, like I needed to get up, whatever it was. I didn't understand. I didn't know how hurt I was at the time. I didn't know the severity of the situation at the time. It was just something that I just felt that I needed to get up. So Jason actually helped me up and got me back on my feet. And I remember walking back onto the freeway from the shoulder. As I got back onto the freeway, I remember all these ambulances started coming and all these bright lights started to flash right in front of my face right there on the freeway. And all I could hear was somebody telling them, it's like, get them down on the ground, like put them down on the ground. And as they put me down on the ground, I couldn't really see anything, and the reason being was the description was that it seemed as though somebody threw a can of red paint, like on my face, so my whole face was just covered. The reason for that was I actually had a head injury. I remember my mom coming there, and I couldn't see her, but I could actually hear her voice, and she kind of asked me what was wrong. And I told her, and she was crying, I told her, I said she didn't have to cry, that, you know, I'm hurt, but, you know, I'm not going to die. And I remember literally telling her that. From there, they put me on the gurney, they stripped my clothes off, and then actually transported me to the helicopter, which landed, you know, right there on the freeway. And from there, I actually don't remember. I don't know if I blacked out or what, but when I opened my eyes again, I was actually on a gurney, but at the hospital. My mom and dad, you know, by my side, and the doctor there. And again, during this whole process, I really couldn't tell you what was going through my head at the time, because I really didn't know. I mean, there was a lot of confusion. And even at the hospital, I remember still being able to move my legs. And, you know, and then at one point it got, I guess, the swelling from the injury to my back, whatever it was. It caused the feeling to go away from my legs and the movement. And I remember telling my mom, you know, if she could move my leg for me. And they said, oh, no, you can do it. And I said, I can't. Like, you know, I can't move. And then right then and there, I think that's when they actually, you know, labeled it as a spinal cord injury, incomplete paralysis. And that, I mean, that was it. That's basically what happened tonight.
How did you feel at Kaiser when it's just flooded with cards and the support? How did that feel? Like the whole city of the layup shelter, basically.
Yeah, I mean, it's something that you can't forget. I mean, what that can do to you, how that can lift, you know, your spirits up. Just knowing that people cared and the support that people brought, you know, to that room. I mean, the positive energy that filled that room, you know, you marks on the wall just kind of reminded me that people care, you know, regardless of however I looked at the time, having a, you know, head injury, having a soft spot on your forehead with a dent in your forehead, just, you know, having them shaved off your hair off, and just really feeling like, man, you know, not yourself, but people still came. People didn't look at the outer. You know, I still have my inner man, and I still have my personality about myself and my inner spirit, and that's what people looked at. It definitely helped me. It definitely wanted me to work hard, and it motivated me to not want to be in this situation, you know, for the rest of my life. I felt that if they can outpour all that support to me, you know, the least that I can do is just work hard and show them that I appreciate everything, you know, that they brought. It was uplifting just seeing all that. Like I said, it's something that I won't forget. You know, something that I'll always be grateful and, you know, appreciative for.
Let's talk about the comeback. Let's talk about the rehab and just what's going through your mind, and then just the determination that I'm going to get back. Let's talk about that.
Well, the first thing, you know, the doctor tells you the diagnosis is that, you know, this can happen or that can happen. You know, you won't walk again, or, you know, you have a head injury, brain damage, you won't be able to, you know, function right, you're going to have to rely on, you know, care 24/7. You know, all those things that they tell you, you know, you kind of have to just kind of block it out, because it can be, I mean, depressing, you know, to hear that, you know, especially at 16 years old, you know, you really haven't even really lived your life yet, and something like that happens, and to hear that, I mean, you don't want to hear it. But just being a competitor, playing sports my whole life and growing up, I knew it was something that I can actually just take on, you know, head on. I made up in my mind day one, once I'm able to actually get up and, you know, start to lift weights and start to do my rehab and my physical therapy, you know, that I wouldn't look back. So I set out a goal to accomplish things, and, you know, everything that I've set out, I've accomplished so far. I mean, it hasn't been easy. You know, you have those days to where, you know, you just sit back and kind of think, you know, why me? Why did this have to happen? You know, why do I have to go through all this? Why do I have to learn how to tie my shoes again? Why do I have to learn how to just be able to sit up? You know, all those things you kind of wonder. You know, but at the same time, you just kind of revert back to all the positive things that the people, you know, instilled in me, as far as encouraging words and just, you know, just being there, and all that actually kind of helped me block out all the negative energy. And I mean, it was hard, but for the most part, like I said, everything that I've gone through, everything that I've, you know, been through, whether the good or the bad, I wouldn't go back for anything. I don't have any regrets over anything. You know, it's just, you just gotta move forward. You just gotta persevere, you know, through it all. I definitely have more good days and bad days, for sure. And, you know, I'm still working right now. I'm still determined, still motivated. You know, I still have that same attitude that I've had, and that is even stronger now, you know, to know that I'm not satisfied with where I'm at. It's just, but I know it takes time, you know, I know it's not on my time. Only thing I can do is just continue to just work hard, stay positive, have a good attitude about the situation, and just continue to move forward.
Before the accident, how close were you to God? Were you a born again believer, or as opposed to where you are now after the accident?
Well, I mean, just growing up as a kid, you know, your parents would take you to church, religious per se. I believed in God. I was saved at the time. But just after the accident, I kind of actually just drew closer to Him. You know, sometimes when you go through things and behind closed doors and people don't really have an answer for you, or people really can't understand like what you're actually going through or how you feel, sometimes God is the only one that can actually give you that comfort that you need. And I mean, right after my accident, I told my mom, I said, you know, when I'm able to actually come home and be home for good after I get out of the hospital, man, I want to go to church. And that's when we first visited the Bible Center. And from there, we never looked back. I mean, we've been there, or we've been members since, I believe it was 99, and now it's, you know, 2012. I mean, God's just been doing so many things in my life and my family's lives, and I mean, it's been a blessing all the way around, you know. And there's times where it's like, you know, you go to Him and you cry to Him, and you even ask Him, you know, but He's always made a way for me, no matter what. You know, even when I felt like I wanted to give up or, you know, or not go on, He would always give me that strength. He would always just be there to push me and let me know that, you know, you can do it.
Let's talk about the afterlife. Let's talk about purgatory.
She's been there. I mean, she's somebody that you can actually go to and talk to. She's positive. There's times where she's given me, you know, the support that I need. And I'm just proud to be able to actually be married to her, you know, in October and just start, you know, start a family and do those things. So she's definitely an inspiration to me.
Any closing remarks? Move back. Day you walk. What's going on? Tell me about that day.
Well, I kind of made up in my mind all these different things or all these different scenarios of what I would actually do once I'm actually back on my feet again. I mean, you can make up all these different things and ideas of what you would do, but until it actually happens, you know, there's no telling what I may do. I mean, I don't know. I really can't tell you. Run around the city with a window. Who knows? I know I'm not going to sit down. I may go to sleep standing up. But, you know, what I want to say, though, is just the community, everybody that's been there. You know, I actually haven't had the chance to really just thank everybody. All my family, my friends, my old coaches, my teachers, my church family, just everybody. Everybody that's actually played a part in my life from me being a little kid till now. I definitely want to just thank everybody for that and for just always being there. I mean, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for everybody playing some type of role in my life. Everybody has some important role that they play. Definitely been a, you know, a blessing for me. I'll be fairly grateful for it.
That's right. Good.
excited. Love playing baseball. I remember we did, I can recall when we lived at Love's Apartments, that's near Dan Fogel. He would chase my brother and I around the apartment building. They didn't play baseball with him, chasing us, and I was moving back. And he would swing at us, so he was always into sports. And he was always, you know, really fast. And you might be his parents. He was, he got along with me, all his friends. And fast like light. That's one thing I remember. We went to Disneyland together, pretty much every year. And his birthday and my mother's birthday are the same day. And my birthday and his mother's birthday are the same day. So we always celebrate and have parties and have all these. Those are most of the things I can recall.
What did you think about when you saw him playing? Saw him playing football, saw him playing basketball, baseball. How related to that guy? What were you thinking?
Just a natural athlete. I was supposed to get it from his dad. His dad was fast like the wind too. So it's like it was just inherited within him. That's why I don't understand how his legs got taken from him, because I can see him. I used to have to record it back in when my cousin was playing baseball. Mainly, I remember Uncle Rowe had me holding a big video camera, and I would have to take every inning, first to the sixth, you know. So I can recall when he was lefty, so he would mostly do drag runs down third baseline. He did that every time. He might be able to turn into a devil. And you know, from a young age, he just had real natural ability. And it enhanced as he got older. But he took the sports real easy, like basketball. I can recall one of my road trips with him to L.A., you know, we played for the youth basketball team. They had tournaments. And one of the memorable, most memorable moments that I recall was when we went to Arizona. We went to near Phoenix, Peoria, Arizona. He was going to baseball camp where the Padres and the Mariners have spring training. And they had to do a race. Like, I think it was almost the last day of the camp. And he was about 14 at the time, maybe 13. And there were, it was competition like all over the country. And they had a race, like it was the equivalent distance from home to second base, but in the spring. And I remember side betting with somebody, I said, I bet my cousin's gonna be everybody racing. He was pretty much the smallest one out there. And all I remember when the coach said go, his head went up and his hat fell off. And next thing I know, he's halfway down the hill and everybody else pretty much stopped running. And I was like, wow, I've never seen anybody that fast. So well, we had a lot of good times together. Yeah.
What do you feel about, not the actor, just what do you feel about James, just the person?
He has a lot of character and drive and determination. Class act. I recall when he was coming home from recovery from, first he was in John Muir Hospital, and then he was in Kaiser. One of his first few days that he came home, his mother would lay with him in bed, like late evening, 8 or 9. And he started to count his 1 through 10s. And he went in and he said, Mom, what's the number after 3? He didn't know the number after 3. And this was when he was already a late teen. And so he went from that to becoming a college graduate. You know, he's engaged now, homeowner. So it showed a lot of determination and will to succeed, even though he was prepped for the majority of his life to be a professional athlete, but he turned a tragedy excited about the wedding that's coming up in October. And, I plan on having a lot more time to spend with the family and being able to share quality moments with them and have a lot of good laughs.
James Steve, and he plays baseball, and I'm that type of dad. And I try to be that type of dad that I used to see Roy. And both parents, great parents. And, you know, I've always admired that about the McClanahan family. Great family. And later on, I got to meet his entire family through an unfortunate accident. But you need that. You need that to get by. He had it. You know, he had it. The willpower that you have in sports, he had it, and it carried him through so far through life, and he's doing excellent things. And I'm just honored to be here, to be honest with you.
What were you doing tonight? Come back from?
The night of the accident, I can remember getting a call and going to the hospital and spending a lot of time at the hospital. I moved to Vallejo because I had a brother who got in a car accident. Same thing. He actually was a quadriplegic, broke his neck. I was 12 years old, and that's the reason that brought me to Vallejo. So this hit home. This hit home. This hit home. So it was really deep for me. It brought back a lot of memories. Did the whole Kaiser thing, did the entire thing that the McClanahan family went through. I was going through it again with them. So it was tough. It was tough. Exactly where I was probably at home at the time. I was already married. I was probably at home, I would think. But the other boys were close to me too, so it was a tough time. It was a tough time for the community.
Maybe words to describe things.
Three words now, I don't even know if three words would justify. His will, not just as an athlete, but what he's gone through is tremendous because I've actually seen it, lived it. My brother's no longer around, so I've actually seen it. I can see you can go one way or the other. And I don't have a number for you, but most don't have the determination of what we're doing in James has and the family. So that willpower that James has, just that work ethic. It's a work ethic that he was raised with, whether it was sports when he was younger, carried him. I think it carried him through, and without a doubt, his family. His family carried him through. James is a role model, and to me, he's a role model. To see him getting married, to see him drive, to see him get a college degree, to see the job that he's maintained, phenomenal. It's not too many young men can do that. So he's like a little role model. I actually got players that I look back upon, and there's a few of them that I look upon like, man, that, you know, wow, could I have done that? And James is one.
Some of the great ones that came from Vallejo that you remember, what was the James way with those guys? Since you moved down here, that you remember from, You know,
I've been out here, obviously, man, I don't want to tell my age, but it's been close to 25 years, probably 25 years now, that I've been here. James is definitely in the top 10. Athletic-wise, he's right there. I mean, man, he was so gifted. Like I said, he's doing some of the things he was doing defy logic. You know, you're lefty. Lefty should probably be in the center. I mean, he was gifted. It was not no, you know, he was okay there. He was pretty good. I mean, I'm sure they probably would have eventually been a center fielder or something. He probably would have been an outfield or smaller guy. You know, he probably would have been an outfield, I'm thinking. But his speed and the little things that he could do as well as all the big things, I think he definitely would have been in the major leagues, no doubt. No doubt. But his determination and what I see with what James has gone through, he had the talent. So definitely one of my top 10 three guys, period. Just he's just overall guy. He's just that's not important to me.
Final remarks.
DeMarcus?
Final remarks.
Final remarks. I love the Planahan family. Great family. And I don't think James could have did it without them. But I don't know. I don't know. That willpower is something special. But you need that family, and I lived it, went through it. Just really proud and anxious to see him start his family. Hopefully spend more time. Maybe get together, do something special, maybe do something special. What do we have? A clinic, a baseball tournament, whatever. I'd like to maybe do something like that for Jay. Alright. Thank you. So he had to hit the high on the wild factor. Another thing, when you see James now and what he go through, what he been through, a tragic accident, and to see him, when I talk to him, he still has that same personality, same smile, still the most humble kid I ever met in my life. If you see that, and that don't make you want to be positive, make you want to do something, make you want to help somebody else, then you don't have a heartbeat. I'm just being truthfully honest with you. Because when I see him, he's the same person he was before. His personality never changed. He's still humble,
Still smiling when I'm seeing him. Every time I see him, what's up, Sam? He's still the same person. I respect him for that. And that, if that don't, this movie is going to inspire somebody, because that don't make you want to do something, be positive. I don't care if it's anything positive. If this story don't make you do that, then you don't have a heartbeat. And I got one. He's why I'm, especially when I got a son now, so it's totally different the way I look at things. And I can kind of go back to seeing how Roy and his parents interact with him. I do the same thing with my son on the baseball field, practicing and teaching him how to make the right choice, be positive, stay humble, keep God first. There's a lot of things, looking and being around James, that you can learn and that can last you a lifetime. So I love James Mack, man. I lived down the street for him about 5 years. Got a lot of respect for him and his parents. Little Mr. Roy, appreciate letting him come to his house, play on the basketball court, snacks, great sandwiches, and all that. So, much love, Jay, man. This is going to inspire a lot of people. Trust me. I believe that.
Help name some of the greats that ever came from this city and where James brings to those times.
We got a lot of great ones. A lot of great ones. And, you got the Kevin Deans, you got the CC, you got the Chris Smith, and you got, but if you look at the whole thing, though, if you look at what James did at his age, put his age at their age, I put James' age when he came up and them at the same age, James probably is one of the best athletes that ever lived to come out of the world. Because he was doing those things at 9, 10, 12 years old that some people don't do today, 15. He doing that at 10. So, I wish I could have saw him when he went to, he would have been a major league player for sure. So, in my eyes, James, after doing this and really thinking about it and just seeing Jay, I think he got to be top 10, top 5 of all time. Just look at the history, though. How many people can you name that did what he did at 9, 10 years old? Japan, traveling. I mean, gifted, just truly gifted.
Any final remarks?
Only final remarks, I got mad love for James. Respect him a lot. I just heard he getting married, so that's congratulations on that for you, James. And I mean, he inspired me. I don't think James ever knew this, though, because I never told him that, but just seeing how he carried himself and being around his dad, how hard he worked, he inspired me. So I got a lot of love for James, and I respect him from my heart.
All right. Mark is now 30.